Hi, everybody. It's Hallie Hera. Thanks for joining me today. I'm all set to record. I have a number of presentations I want to record for you today. So, of course, that means that there's lawn mowing going outside. My dog is next to me making all sorts of noise. So we'll just do the best we can. The first thing that I want to start with today, as far as our externship topic is concerned, is a very fundamental concept. And that is, how is an externship different from a part-time job? And I've been doing externship work for many, many years. And one thing has remained the same in that people tend to talk about a part-time job and an externship the same. The distinguishing characteristic seems to be, oh, you're doing an externship for credit. That's what makes it different. And that's really not true. There's a whole lot more to it. So that's what this short video is designed to address. Okay, so on the surface, an externship and a part-time job can look very similar. They can be for pay or no pay. The ABA has lifted the restrictions on paid externships, so that depends on your institution. They can be for credit or no credit, right? Sometimes people accept externships and they're actually not looking for credit from their institution. And sometimes they can even be repeated, right? You can work somewhere more than one semester or extern somewhere more than one semester. So what are the key differences? Because on the surface, they really can be confusing. But the key difference is the externships have defined learning objectives. So the sort of key text for externships in law school is a book called Learning from Practice. And there's the question, for those of you who have it, right at the outset, how is an externship different from a job? And the answer is, you can do incidental learning at a job, right? So, and they define that as unintentional or unplanned learning that results from activities. So, you just sort of happen to learn something new today, but you do so without planning to learn, without thinking about it. There is very much a learning cycle that goes with experiential learning, and that really is the key difference. So what might be some learning objectives that you plan for? So you have these, aspirational big goals, hopefully, for your externship and what you're hoping to accomplish there. And then you're going to break those down into smaller pieces, your learning objectives. So here's some examples. These may not be yours for your externship, but I wanted to provide you some examples. So, increase your understanding of the skills necessary to effectively perform the legal work, to develop a deeper understanding of substantive law and legal issues. Let's say you're working on landlord-tenant work in your externship, maybe that's something you're looking to learn a whole lot more about during the course of the semester. To improve your skills, such as research, writing, analysis, oral advocacy. It's one thing to try those out in the classroom, different thing to try those out in the field. To enhance your understanding of ethics and professional identity. To develop productive working relationships and explore career options. And to engage in critical self-reflection to promote self-directed lifelong learning, which is required of all lawyers. So these are some examples of some strategies or means to attain those big aspirational goals that you've set for yourself during your externship. And there's a structure in place. I mean, you really have two people to guide you through this, as opposed to, in a part-time job, sometimes the only feedback you get is your paycheck, right? Or not even that if you're volunteering. But in the experiential learning structure, it exists to satisfy your educational objectives. So you come in as a law student with foundational knowledge that you acquire through your classroom learning. Most institutions, like the institution where I am, you are required to have completed your first year of legal study before you're able to go into the field and get credit for an externship. And then once you have that in place, then you also have an externship supervisor there who has said, okay, listen, I have looked at the ABA requirements. I've looked at your institution's requirements, and I'm committed to teaching you and guiding you in the field. So we have a commitment. The law schools have a commitment, and the ABA has a commitment from these supervisors that say, yes, I will provide guidance, evaluation, and feedback to facilitate learning at my site. And then the externship professor is another layer of, you know, sort of ensuring that you're getting a quality educational learning opportunity during your externship, and encourages you to not only learn, but then reflect on your learning throughout the course of the 14 weeks. So it really does have a very specific structure and specific requirements in order to qualify as an externship. So, you know, now that you know that there is this focus on learning, that's really the distinguishing difference. Okay, so how do you go about, where do I even start? And I'm going to remind you of that acronym that you've probably heard many times, and that's to be smart about your externship. The SMART acronym is often used in many different contexts as a strategy for achieving objectives. So, you know, what I would like you to do at the beginning of your externship is set some SMART goals for yourself. And what that means is that the goals be specific. They be measurable, achievable. So you can't say, you know, I want to be CEO of this corporation, right? Has to be something within reason for the semester where you are working. Realistic, right? Those things are go hand in hand. And time bound, right? Must be timely, must occur within a reasonable amount of time. So if you are my student, I'm going to guide you through setting those goals for yourself. That's sort of what comes next. But there's nothing stopping you from setting these goals yourself at the outset, and then using those as criteria to check back in with your site supervisor, with your professor throughout the course of the semester. So yes, I set these goals on week one. Let's check in at week seven and see how that's going. You know, if one of my goals was to improve my oral advocacy by watching, observing court proceedings or arguments, or participating in moots, and it's week seven and I have not made any progress toward that goal, it's a good time to check in and recommit to those goals, right? So you can use them throughout to make sure that you don't sort of just let the experience wash over you, that you're actually being very deliberate about your learning to get everything you can from your externship. And then at the end, you know, kind of reflecting back, how did I meet those goals? Did I actually end up setting some different goals along the way? And how did I do at achieving those? So it gives you something, the M in SMART, measurable, that you can look back on and really see what you've learned. And then since you're using this to sort of build your skills, build your experience, you can look back on this and say, you know, if someone says, tell me about your externship at the court, you could say, actually, one goal I had for myself was X, and here's how I satisfy it. So it gives you sort of a good elevator pitch for your experience too. So really the key difference, bottom line, the key difference between an externship and a part-time job is, you know, that deliberate intention toward learning, right? And the reflection incorporated and structure incorporated, but it all centers around the learning. And one little footnote I'll add at the end, because someone will have this question, what's the difference between an internship and an externship? It depends on who you ask. In the state of Ohio, where I am, there are specific legal requirements that you have to meet in order to be what we call a legal intern. I have a student who did 3 trials this semester in her externship. She had a legal intern's license, which is really just a very limited, highly supervised access to the practice of law, without engaging in the unauthorized practice of law. So a general externship does not carry that accreditation with it, but I'm sure your state has requirements for getting a legal intern's license. So that's the difference between an internship and an externship. So now that you're ready to go, I want you to set those goals for yourself and just know that I'll always be rooting for you. Thanks.